$2.3 million. This is up in the left-hand corner of this sheet. $2.34 site appeals. $3 million for finance and sports medicine stuff. Another $2 million which would finance the locker room wing. And another $1.5 million which would finance a second floor. Now, at this juncture, bond support is not proposed to lease a second floor. But since the building is being built, the EDA suggests that we concur that we should build the second floor first as a whole dark shell. And then when we find a tenant, when they find a tenant, and they use about $500,000 or $1.5 million to do the tenant addition. The EDA has already had some interest expressed to them with respect to renting a second floor. So the amount of this, $8.8 million would be spent based on what we know at this point. And that bond support would provide $6.4 million towards of that $8.8 in lease payments for annual and annual rents. That's the total of those two. And the PDA would provide $1.5 million. So of the 8.8, all but $900,000 is accounted for in the first 6 years of the deal. The balance would be paid for through the other sponsorship agreements. On the low end, that's expected to raise $5.8 million over 10 years. On the high end, it's expected to raise about $11 million over 10 years. All in all, we think the finances of the deal. Going to the FAQs, the first question is why is this a good deal for the city of Richmond? The deal as proposed would promote job creation and expansion. It would bring in $20 million in new annual payroll and over 200 new jobs, 75 of which would be in the East End. Promotes expanded access to health care throughout the city, throughout the area of the city. And those health services are being excluded, well, I guess, from preventive health services are being expanded in the city, including the East City. It facilitates economic revitalization and underutilized, underinvested part of the city. And overall, between the three sites, there's $40 million in new private investment, 16 of which would be in the East End and Central City. Expands the city's tax base by over $400,000 annually, and it includes a requirement or an agreement that minority participation goals be met. Another question is, so why is Spots growing in pain? $5,000 a year for this. pay $28,000 a year to maintain the hall for the life of the lease. The city would specify the level of maintenance, and we're looking at a very high level of maintenance, not what we normally see around the city facilities. So it's actually $33,000 a year. I tried to explain a moment ago why we are proposing to lease the school as opposed to starting. And again, it's just the mechanism of canceling the deal would not work if we were to sell the site. It's possible that as a standalone deal, West Hampton site, that West Hampton site would be sold and developed. But it's not very likely that if it was sold separately and developed, that you would have the training facility at Lee Street or the expansion of health services in the East End. Most hospitals are moving out of the city, or have moved out of the city. What's happening here is Montrose is not only expanding in at the West Hampton site, they're also proposing to expand services along Lee Street and in the East End. With respect to the question as to why we are shortchanging schools, which is the way it's been presented by some, if you look at the situation in 2008, when the council passed an ordinance to require that any surplus schools that were sold would have those, the proceeds of those sales, or that sale, be used specifically for capital maintenance or capital building schools. At the time, it was about $14.7 million that had been made available to schools between 2005 and 2009, or 2005 and 2008. Between fiscal year 9 and fiscal year 14, which is what is in our budget so far, there's been $140 million made available for school construction. Over $21 million made available for ADA compliance. And $9.5 million made available for just capital maintenance of schools. The council made a decision in 2008 to try to make sure schools were taken care of. And that was a wise decision. And the situation has changed, in that council has put forward a fair amount of money, more than tenfold in amount of money, for school maintenance and school construction since that time. Do we plan to take every school and lease it, every school that's surplus and lease it? The answer is no. We're actually looking at least one other school right now for possible sale, or one other school facility that will be surplus in the next few months. We have a potential buyer. Could come to council with something on that in the very near future, whether that is bid out or actually sold to an individual to one buyer, if the deal is can be negotiated. But the notion is that this was a unique deal, the West Hampton side is a unique deal. And it's not one we expect that would be replicated for an individual basis. But each deal has to stand on its own. Another question is, why are we taking money from the jail and from the schools? And what impact will it have on those five projects? At finance, I talked a little about what the current projections are for the school and the jail. The jail has had $120 million appropriated up to this point. We expect to expend during through June 30th of this year about 96 points to 94, 96. We will ultimately spend over 100, somewhere in the neighborhood of $134 million on that project. And so additional dollars will be appropriated in future years. Additional dollars have been approved. It's not appropriated in the capital budget. If we only spend $96 million in this year, we can move $5.5 million into next fiscal year, which starts July 1. And we can move $4 million from the schools construction. Denver and two other cities. And they both were coming in, but just those two alone is a savings of approximately $3 million. We're asking to move four in to next fiscal year. So the projects will not be hampered. It will not be overspent, nor will they want a lot of money, and they won't be delayed. The other question is, why hasn't the public been more involved in this process? And that's a question about impact. There's a long list of dates that I'm talking to. So the hard date is this facility has to open in early July 2013 for Christmas, so that they can begin the camp. And it was in June of 2012, June 6th, that the governor and the mayor announced that the team would be retained in Virginia and expanded. 2 weeks later, on June 19th, the mayor announced formulation of a steering committee to identify and review possible sites for the Redskins training camp here in Richmond. On July 18th and July 26th, the steering committee met, and there was a report from the mayor on the progress the committee had made in looking at a number of sites. And on August 30th, the steering committee recommended the two top sites. So between June 6th, when the deal was announced that the Redskins would stay in the state head, would be coming to Richmond, and August 30th, the steering committee had narrowed down the sites from, I think, was about 8 down to 2. A week after they made the recommendation to the mayor, which was September the 6th, the city actually approached two different companies about being sponsors. Two different entities, I won't say both companies. And negotiated with them both trying to get them to sponsor and build on that site, on a site. The Redskins indicated that their preferred site was Leach's site. And the Environment Board agreed on September 10th, which was 4 days later, that they were interested in this sponsorship. On October 22nd, the mayor announced the selection of the Leach Street site and a deal, a potential deal with the Bronson Board. I said all that to show that in just a few weeks, this whole deal went from something that was proposed to a real deal. People often question the city's ability to get big deals done. This is something that's been done very, very quickly. It's something you couldn't negotiate about. You can't negotiate a multi-million dollar deal in newspapers or in public hearings. However, now we're at the point where the deal has to be reviewed by the public, reviewed by this body, and decisions have to be made. So beginning on November 8th, held at Science Museum. November the 12th, the full council had a hearing. November the 15th, Finance and Economic Development had a hearing. There'll be another public meeting tonight. We're doing a public meeting now. And the other thing that has to be kept in mind, since the West Hampton site is zoned for residential, a special use permit or possibly build an additional building there that has office uses or hospital uses. So that will take 4 to 6 months of public input. We had to move fast in order to put the deal together because we had a hard date, and that date is July 8th to get the facility built. Construction itself is going to take at least 6 months. If we get started in late December, we'll be able to complete it by the end of June, which is just in time. That's been the impetus for moving as quickly as we have. And as I said, we really can't negotiate a deal like this yet. But we're at the point now where
we had a question,